I'm Sawyer, and you're listening to Our House, A to Z.
Welcome back.
Hey, thanks for stopping by again, guys.
Good morning, Vietnam.
Good morning, Vietnam!
Happy Friday.
Oh, yeah, that's it, yeah. Remember Robin Williams?
Hello! Look at me from the side. Do I look different to you?
No.
I only remember it because you did it before here on the podcast, that same thing. And then I said, what is that? And you said, remember Robin Williams? And you started talking about the show. I feel like I'm living in Groundhog's Day.
Yeah.
Or just weird deja vu.
Like a year ago.
Season 2. Episode 16.
It was just weird deja vu.
There's just iconic ways to like open up these shows, and that's one of them. So I'm going to lean back.
Lean back.
What else we got?
Lean back.
What's your iconic way to open the show?
I don't really have an iconic way.
I want to hear it. Just come up with something.
I don't have anything. I'm not an iconic kind of person.
That's not true.
I'm a steady Eddie.
You're an icon in our house.
Yeah. I'm not an icon right now. I've been removed from my throne.
Talk about it. Go ahead.
The problem is if I talk about it, everybody here is going to approach my children and talking about it. And then it's going to be then they're going to get upset.
Okay. All right.
So I can only tell everybody on the podcast if you promised you're not going to say anything.
We're going to be out of town when it comes out this time. So.
That's true. But no, that's not true, actually.
All right.
You are. No, you're not going to be. We're all going to be here.
Oh, we'll be back for Sunday.
So many of you know we have two boys.
Yeah.
That have long hair. One of them has had hair that has grown and grown and grown and grown, and he has not cut it in a long time. I mean, I think I trimmed it a year ago before school started, but he, not even for the fact that he really likes long hair, he has a little bit of like, he doesn't like things to change. He's kind of like, just let everything stay the same all the time forever.
It's a comfort thing.
A comfort thing. So he's the one that, like, if we paint a room, he's like crying. If we like change, I remember changing countertops when he was like
anything, furniture,
moving furniture. I mean, every single thing.
Cars.
Now,
he doesn't like when we get a new car.
No, he does not want you to ever get a new car. But what you need to know is I have that same thing. I always had that exact same thing. I never wanted anything to change. Don't change the carpet. Don't change this. Don't add anything. I like things staying the same. So
I don't have that.
I got to a point that it was time to cut the hair. It was very long, halfway down the back. It's time. They're also at an age where they're showering, but not every day. They're not everyday showers. Yeah.
To intermittently.
They're not quite there yet. They actually don't even need to shower. They're not wearing deodorant yet. They don't need like anything like that yet. So
I'm not sure if I'd say they don't need to shower, but okay.
Well, I'm saying they're not like sweating with like,
they don't
smell like body odor or anything like that.
They don't.
They're not quite there yet. So
they're not clean either.
They're still playing outside. Yes, they're still boys. Anyway, we decided it's time to cut the hair, and it's been a long talked about conversation. And we're parents that are fine with longer hair. I'm not. Zach's always had longer hair. I'm not somebody that needs to have like military haircuts or short hair above the
ears
or anything
collar.
Like that. We've kind of been really like lax with that because it's not just a thing we care about. But it was getting rat's nesty, too hard for him to brush every single day, all that kind of stuff. So we decided to cut it. The response was really, I mean, it was like Armageddon.
Barbaric!
I mean, it was like
sackcloth and ashes.
Yeah, it was horrific. It was actually from both boys. One just got a trim, barely noticeable. Both of them are ill
now, the irony,
with me.
The irony of is that he felt like having shorter hair looked more like a girl.
Yep.
Which was really weird.
Yep. I wasn't going to say all the details about that kind of stuff. He doesn't want to talk. They don't want to talk about all that kind of stuff. But needless to say, I have fallen way far.
Mother.
Off of the throne. Yeah. I mean, it is like,
Mother, I crave violence.
Fallen from grace.
I have fallen from grace is an understatement. They don't even want to talk to me right now. They can't do anything but like cry. And I'm hoping by some miracle that by the time this podcast come out that we've made it a little farther.
Well, what I'd like to believe is that there is a hunting trip that may or may not be in their future. And
right.
I have no problem using that as leverage because it should be a privilege to
right.
go.
It's a rite of passage.
Bird hunting in the fall, not an obligation on our part as
right.
parents. And so if they're going to be disrespectful and unappreciative and ungrateful, then guess what?
I mean, I don't need them to be appreciative of the haircut. I mean, I didn't expect appreciation by any means.
Well, I do.
Appreciation?
Thanks,
for
Mom.
A haircut?
Like,
no.
Just simple thanks. Not quite the one I was hoping for, but it's okay. It'll grow back.
And one of them, the one who had really long hair, I cut his hair way too short, and it was not even on purpose. I was like, thinking I was going to leave it like longer, but the way he was sitting, he was so slouched because he was so mad, and I thought it was still a couple inches down his back.
Serves
it is
right.
So shoulder like, like maybe above the shoulders unintentionally, but
it looks great.
That's where we are, and he is ticked at me.
Yeah, he'll be all right.
I feel like, I know, but do you think out of just the fact, this is, I'm going to tell you why I feel like a little bit bad about it. Not only do I feel bad because he's upset about it, I do feel a little bit guilty because I feel like there's part of me that like knew better to like, and that's why I was going to leave it longer, like some longer, was that I know like how sensitive he is to change and that I have that same thing. And I feel like it was too drastic all at once. Like, I feel like I should have done, like, half that much, and then, like, a couple months be like, hey, it's time for a trim again, and I don't know.
Yeah.
I do feel really bad. It was not on purpose.
I don't feel bad. I feel bad for how they reacted. I feel like it made me second guess whether or not I've been disciplining them enough.
Oh, my gosh, Zach.
That's feel like it was, like, over the top.
They were emotional. It was late. They couldn't go to sleep because they were so horrified
by
their hair.
That's why I'm willing to give it another chance after school today. And see how we're doing.
Well, I mean, it was like everybody's going to make fun of us at school. I mean,
yeah,
like they literally think that everybody's going to make fun of them because they got their hair cut shorter. Right. And it's so weird.
It is weird. But anyway, it's all good. You know what? These are the woes. These are the
kids' minds. So what you're not going to do, our house listeners, is say anything.
Nothing!
You're just going to pretend it's totally normal.
Good day, sir!
You don't even need to say your haircut looks great. You don't even need to do that.
I would.
You're just going to ignore it. You're going to pretend their hair always looked just like it does.
Yeah. Good. Okay, so with that, yeah.
If you care about us at all.
Yeah, thank you.
And if you don't, I'm going to ask my kids on Sunday if anybody mentioned their haircuts.
Yeah.
And I'm going to find you out by name.
We'll get to the bottom of this. And we will ban you from the show. Just kidding. Okay, so moving on in our series, and I want to give a special thanks to the people who have been texting, emailing, and just coming up and saying, hey, what about this passage?
Yes. Oh, my gosh. So many.
It turns out that there's a lot more controversial scripture than even I had.
So many.
Given the Lord credit for.
I love that everybody has their own. They're like, this is the thing that has like always bothered me. So many this week people have been bringing up. And I love it, too. What I have noticed is that they're all Old Testament stories. Every single one is an Old Testament story, which is kind of what we brought up in the very beginning, that there's so many things in the Old Testament that bother me. Yeah. Like there's so many to pick from that are hard to swallow.
A different dispensation too.
I know.
Things are different, but we'll get back to some Old Testament stuff too. But today I think we wanted to reach into the New Testament.
We decided we'd do it for the month of October. It's going to be our frustrating Bible stories series. We'll be
Even
through
though
October.
We could probably go through the end of the year.
But we're not going to because that'd be boring. Okay.
I don't know. I'm liking this. These are
so
exciting.
We really had our hearts set on doing something from the New Testament. I feel like it's harder to find things you don't like in the New Testament.
Yeah, because there's that whole like Jesus story where we're like saved from hell and get to go
I know.
To heaven.
Well, I mean, there's like the frustration with Jesus having to go to the cross for our salvation. Like, was there no other way that it could have been?
Deconstructionists say, yes, there was another way. And that's actually not what saved us.
They do?
Yep. And they say that it's impossible.
Those deconstructionists.
It's impossible for one man's sacrifice to cover the wages of even his own sin, let alone anybody else's.
Okay.
And for that reason, the whole correctional system in America is under attack because it's saying that the way that we have organized the institution of correctional, you know, practices, that it's impossible for them to actually
be fruitful.
Or it's
like blood for blood kind of thing.
Like, yeah. It's like time served. Like there's no way that to do penance, like to do time for your sin. It just doesn't work. So they're saying that, no, it's impossible. If we're saved, it's because God is good, not because Jesus died.
Okay.
That is not true.
I mean, you actually have to throw away a lot of the Bible.
Pretty much the whole Bible.
Pretty
much like just the whole Bible. Yeah. So
to get to that.
Yeah. But anyway, that's all right because, you know, I think we're living in a time when it's important to dig into these controversial scriptures. We're not just doing this for fun. I think that it's important to understand that even behind the things that are hard to swallow, there is a measure of God's heart that's important for us to understand. Mm-hmm. So
that's good. All right. So the story we chose to talk about today is a little bit less of a story and more of words that Jesus shared. Do you want me to read it from my translation? Do you mind?
Yeah. Do you have Zach's living version?
Yes. All right. So this is Luke 12, and we're going to start at verse 49 through 53. All right. This is Jesus talking. He says, I have come to set the world on fire, and I wish it were already burning. I have a terrible baptism.
Can we just stop right there? I mean, that's like
I know.
What a powerful statement. Thank
I'm
you,
like,
Lord.
Jesus, when you said you meant to, like, you came to set the world on fire, is that like good fire? Is that like with the Holy Spirit? Like,
or is that like, I'm going to burn this down to the ground? Either way.
Either way. It's like, BA. Which one of those is that?
Either way.
I don't know which one it is. I'm sure somebody who has the Greek translation can tell us.
I feel like I see Jesus coming out in like a WWE belt with like, oh he's gosh. Walking out and there's like heavy metal music.
Isn't there playing. A song, a pop song, like Here to Set the World on Fire or something like that? I can't remember.
Listen to pop.
Come to Set the World on Fire. This girl is on fire. Maybe not pop. Anyway, I have a terrible baptism of suffering ahead of me, and I'm under a heavy burden until it is accomplished. Do you think I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I have come to divide people against each other. From now on, families will be split apart, 3 in favor of me and 2 against, or 2 in favor and 3 against. Father will be divided against son and son against father. Mother against daughter and daughter against mother. And mother-in-law against daughter-in-law and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. Do I have to read more? That's it.
Well, there's certainly a head start on that last one. I mean, I feel like there are a lot of
oh my gosh,
a lot
that's
of
terrible.
In-law discrepancies already at hand, but that's hard.
I mean, it's very hard. Well, I feel like so much of it is talking about how Jesus is the great reconciler, and he's coming to redeem broken relationships and redeem people and bring yes. unity and well, all these things. We're called to be a united bride and
well,
all
point,
of this stuff.
At one point, he actually says, you think I came to bring peace? I came to turn you all against each other. But then it says, unless you hate. When he's talking about following me, he's like, you can't
oh, yeah.
follow me unless you hate your own
yes.
family or unless
yes.
you hate whatever. And it's like, man, like, wow, this is like Jesus on the wrong side of the bed or
yeah.
something. But even Jesus in a bad mood.
Well,
even
it's like
when
the hate.
Mad,
wait, I'm supposed to hate the people I'm called to love?
Yeah.
Like, how does
exactly.
that make any sense?
So, yeah, let's talk about it. What do you think it means?
Oh, gosh. I'm not the theologian in the room.
What's the way you've always interpreted it? People don't want to hear from a theologian, they want to hear from a normal person.
I'm the one with the questions. I mean, what it's always meant is that you have to, like, to me, is that you have to put, as like cliche as Jesus first. Like, all of those things.
Mm-hmm. Tell me more.
Your relationship with him is more important. It has to be like priority in everything you do. And so if it comes to, I mean, even I've talked to people before about like, there's a commandment that's honor your mother and father, like honor your mother. Like, what if they want us to sin? Like, I remember being in like classes, like in middle school and talking about the.
Well, that's a relevant question when it comes to your parents.
So. Oh my gosh.
Just kidding. Just kidding, Ron and Doreen.
They listened to this, so you're in big trouble.
It did seem like a little like, oh, really? Is that kind of hypothetical? Or like, what's the reality of that actually materializing that situation? But I think, and John was just in here talking to us a little bit about this too, and I like the way he put it. He lays it out like this. The whole like hating business, it has to be that we're so obsessed and so consumed and so obedient mm-hmm. to the call of Christ, to our relationship with Jesus, to the path that he's called us to walk on, that it makes everything else look like hate.
Right.
So on a Richter scale, mm-hmm. we have to be at a place where whatever we love the most looks like hate compared to
yeah.
whatever we're committed to the most, whatever we're sacrificing to the most, it has to look like hate compared to what we're laying down for Jesus.
Right. And right. Like, how does the Bible say, like, not far from here, that you have to love your neighbor? And it's like, but hate your father. Do you know what I mean? Like how,
right.
I mean, I know a lot of it is just our being able to understand like the English language and it be so
yeah,
limited.
For sure. But I think that these are words of passion. These are words of emotion. They're not words of decision. So it's not a matter of, okay, I'm deciding now to hate this person. It's my emotions, they have to look proportionately extreme.
Mm.
So whatever looks like this extreme allegiance to me, it has to look like disloyalty compared to how sold out I am
right.
for the kingdom.
Right.
And what's interesting is that the Lord also teaches us that when we live our lives that way, when we seek first the kingdom, we'll actually be able to love all those people
better.
Yeah, mm-hmm. we'll actually be able to love them the right way.
Right. Which, by the way, might not feel to them like the right way.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Like, a lot of times I think we end up in those places where we're not loving well enough. And it's like, well, now that I am a believer and I'm following Christ, like, these are my new priorities. and my family's not understanding that, and I'm loving them as best as I can, and they're not receiving it that way. Like, they would literally think I hate them.
Right.
Because it looks so different now.
Yeah. And it's like, well, what happened? We used to do this, yeah. And it used to be this, and we used to go drink with,
like,
us.
The bar was our thing. Like, yeah. That was our thing. That was right. Our place where we hung out.
Or, like, couples, and one gets saved, and the other one's like, why aren't you sleeping with me anymore? And one's like, well, I'm living by these convictions right. That make the other person feel rejected.
Mm-hmm.
They make the other person feel abandoned or hated.
Yeah.
But really, it's that, no, this individual, their life is starting to be lived in the order that God calls us to. And so what it looks like is, where our lives out of order have been consistent with the world's chaos and dysfunction, now suddenly we're walking in a way that is complete 180 degrees the mm-hmm. opposite direction. So it's going to feel like hate.
Yeah. I think what's so interesting in the timeliness of this is when it's saying, from now on, families will be split apart. I mean, that was this last couple of years, I feel like, with mm-hmm. all of the social unrest that has been over the varying degrees over the last couple of years, there literally was families divided over it.
Literally, like, where everybody can come to this birthday party except for the two that are unvaccinated.
Yeah.
Or everybody can...
I mean, we had outdoor weddings that people wouldn't come to
yeah.
the wedding, and we're like, okay, we'll try to set some chairs up, like, further away for them, give them outdoor space, and it was still fights. It was,
right.
It's awful.
Right. It's really sad. One of the things that I love about this, when Jesus says...
Just to clarify, I'm not saying that the Lord was dividing, like allowing the division. I don't want to say that necessarily. I think there were instances maybe, but...
I mean, I think he was certainly allowing it.
Yeah. I think a lot of it was just people's selfishness, to be honest, but...
Absolutely. When Jesus says, I didn't come to bring peace, I came to divide, I love that, and I love how even controversial it is, especially now, because... while we're living amidst all this, you know, social and political unrest and everything, there's this undercurrent in the church that's, let's unite, 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 unite. Let's live in harmony, harmony, peace, peace. We all love the same God. We love the same God.
Well, we know he's called us that he's coming back for one bride.
We do. However, what I think is really important to understand here is that Jesus, the biggest division he brought was in the church. It
right.
was among the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the believers at the time.
Mm-hmm.
The biggest division was people who should have already had a relationship
right.
with Yahweh, you
right.
know, with Jehovah.
So the biggest division that he caused was within the church.
Was Christians.
Like, how is that? It's crazy.
It is crazy, but I think that it's a good wake-up call for us who have been trying to reconcile our belief systems, our value systems, our theologies with that of folks who have compromised theirs.
Mm.
And I think of how hurtful it's been to people when folks have left the church, even in just recent years, folks have left the church because they want to build a theology based on what their burdens, their personal soapboxes, and whatever they feel passionate about. And it's like—
Well, compassion. I feel like a lot of it was built on compassion. Yeah.
Yep. Or anything. I just think that Jesus saying that, it's sort of a slap in the face to all of these efforts that have been, let's unify ourselves even when I'm believing something that's unbiblical and you're believing something that's biblical, we can still be in unity. No, that's called being unequally yoked.
Yeah.
And I think that's why I'm not afraid to say, no, like, we're not in the same boat. Like, we may worship the same God. We may even both believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ, but we're not in the same boat in terms of what it's going to take to see healing and restoration in New England.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it absolutely makes sense. But here's a question. How does Jesus say something like, you think I came to bring peace to the earth? No. When we know he is peace, like, and he's actually did bring peace to the earth. How is he at the same time saying, you think I came to bring peace to the earth, but no, I came to divide?
Well, because the Beatitudes say, Jesus teaches, blessed are the peacemakers, not the peacekeepers.
Mm-hmm.
And in order to make the real eternal peace that the Prince of Peace came to bring, he had to first make war. And that bloodbath, that division, that family turning against itself, that son against father and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law, that war was because he was bringing to the surface this real truth that mm-hmm. people had to live by.
Right.
And so I don't care if you say to me, well, I believe in the gospel. I believe in Jesus. That doesn't matter to me if you are putting above Jesus whatever your personal compassion point is, because now that's really your savior. You might believe in the cross. You might believe in the gospel, but it is not your God.
Yeah.
Your God is a new theology that's built on relevant culturally specific matters.
Well, that's what is so interesting to me. And I was just thinking about, we cannot even comprehend in our American culture right now what Jesus was even saying when it comes to dividing father against son, son against father, mother against father. We can't even comprehend, like, even to the degree of what he was talking about because of where our American culture is.
Correct.
Even the best person is selfish.
Why'd you look at me when you say that?
I didn't. I closed my eyes.
I'm just kidding.
Even the best of the best of us is selfish.
Yeah.
At the time that he's talking about, I mean, we're talking about times when huge families live together.
Right.
Like, literally everything you did was based on your, like, little family unit. I mean, there's a lot of, like, Europeans and that still live this way, where it's like...
No, you're right. So we live in a culture where people haven't talked to their parents in 15 years.
Yes.
And it's like, back then, if you were disowned from the family name, it was, like, the worst thing that could happen to you.
So we it's like almost like we don't even have a rubric for that.
No.
For understanding, like, what he was saying.
Right.
Because it's all like, well, fine. Well, good riddance to them. Like, if they don't like it, fine.
Yeah. No, it's true. And so I think understanding that, first of all, we're so far from what order should have looked like in families and what reconciliation and what peace should have been like. But I think that understanding that Jesus not only allows but actually calls for division between those who will be led by the Spirit of God and say, okay— based on your word and based on your conviction of me, that has to, by the way, align with your word.
Right.
Not like, well, I have this conviction. No, you don't have a conviction. You feel guilty about something.
Yeah.
If you have a conviction, it will be consistent with the word of God. He's saying, unless you're living by that, whatever other, because that was the thing. The Pharisees at the time, the very people that put Jesus on the cross, were championing theology.
Yeah.
They were championing, they did it as a countermeasure to their belief system.
Oh my gosh. So how do we avoid that? How do we avoid, as Christians, our theology being that same place where we're championing something based on our theology?
Well,
because I feel like we can do all that all the time, even when there were, you know, when we're talking about those times over the last couple of years where there's been a lot of division. I mean, there still is, but where we're like, well, let's just go back to the Bible. Like, let's go back to our theology about why we're standing where we are on this matter. Like, how do we avoid doing that?
It's a great question. We have a friend that the Pharisees 2,000 years ago did not have, and that is the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And so this answer is going out to Amanda Bemis, because she told me that I always have the same answer at the end of every podcast.
Yes.
And it's, we have to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Spirit. You have to hear the Spirit of God. But there is a reason for that.
Yeah.
Jesus teaches us that. And Amanda, you're right. And you're right again. We have the Holy Spirit and we have to listen to him. And I think that he will lead us in moments of distraction and doubt and fear. He will lead us in times of uprising. He will lead us with a still small voice when the roar of the crowd is seeking intentionally to drown him out. And so it's in those moments, it's in these seasons of the last couple of years that we've had, when we have to more than ever get off of media, get off of the news, get off of all the things that are seeking to sway us, that are seeking a culture that will build a theology based on what looks important instead of what is important, what looks urgent instead of what heaven says is eternal. If we'll lean back to the Spirit every time, he'll lead us the right way.
It's good.
You know, that's hard stuff to swallow, and but I think we can't be afraid of it. We can't be afraid of the things he is dividing us from, and you know, things that we used to love that, and I actually like it, because it's easier to talk about in terms of stuff instead of people.
Yeah.
Right? When you're talking about people, it's like, oh, I'm supposed to hate so-and-so. But I know people who are like, oh, I used to love this, and now I like, it turns my stomach. You know, because so much of what we love or what we appreciate or what we value, it's connected to brokenness. And so the Lord wants a whole bride. You know, not one that is still so obsessed with her old dress that she wore in high school, the glory days, the former relationship. Well, I'm getting remarried to Jesus, but I'm going to wear the wedding dress I wore when I married the world, you know? And so we have to be willing to put on this new thing.
You're so smart, babe.
Oh, come on. Just stop. But yeah, you're, I mean, it's really, I mean, you don't have to say it, but go ahead, say it again.
Guys, you don't know what I put him through. Trust me. I ask a lot of really hard questions.
You put me through a lot, babe. And I wouldn't have it any other way. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you, God, that even when there's hard things to read and deal with and process and digest, Lord, that you extend a measure of grace so that we can understand these things, so that we can learn and grow and walk in the fullness of your counsel, Lord. So we pray that it would expand within us, Lord, that the leadership of your Spirit would expand within us out into the extremities of our lives, into the little areas. And so, God, if it is relationships, if it is things, God, whatever there have been in our lives that have competed with you, that have been vying for that first place on the throne of our hearts, God, we choose to hate those things in comparison to our love for you, Lord. So lead us and show us, God. Reveal to us what needs to be yanked out of that seat and cast to the side. Maybe we should hate it, God, if it's ever competed with you, because there is none like you. There is no one beside you, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. All right, Our House friends and family, have the best day of your lives, and we will see you next Friday on Our House.
This is Nestor.
And I'm Willa.
This is Our House from A to Z.
Thanks for coming over.
Mother.
It's a rite of passage.
Mother, I crave violence.